drove for miles in the desert, and suddenly you see this forest of columns coming out very high to the sky. And next to it, this village, town, which was created for the occasion of tents. And that was already a fairy tale story.
It was a perfect setup for a James Bond plot. It was so extravagant. It was so exclusive.
It was the budget from Switzerland for 2 years, which they spent in 2 days. It was big, big, big security. It was everywhere. Yes, machine gun on every corner. When you have all the head of states, I mean, yes, so much responsibility.
Historically and politically, it's the only time where everyone met. You had the East, the West, the developed countries, the underdeveloped countries, the communist countries, the monarchies. Everyone was there.
The party is a bit like a debutante's ball. You know, it's basically a coming out. Iran is coming. You know, the idea was, I think, that, oh, you know, we want to join the top tier of nations with a bang. But it was the wrong bang.
If you spend hundreds of millions, you have to answer to somebody. One day you pay.
Sitting in on a television first this morning, the heads of state are about to arrive in Persepolis, Iran, to help celebrate the 2500th anniversary of the founding of the what was once called the Persian Empire. Here we have Barbara Walters. Barbara?
There's so much that one should understand about this event, both historically and in terms of modern times, and I thought I'd try to give you the who, what, where, how, and why right now. Who? Well, our host is the Imperial Majesty Shahanshah, which means King of Kings, Shahanshah of Iran, Mohammad Reza. He's been the Shah since 1941. He's one of the richest men in the world. This country is a constitutional monarchy. The Shah has full power. He appoints the Prime Minister. He can dissolve the parliament. He controls the army. He can declare war. He can conclude peace treaties. He controls the press. Very little criticism of him is allowed. His word is indeed the law.
I have this firm belief that I have a mission to accomplish. And I believe in God. This is why I say I think that I have a divine command of doing what I'm doing. And this, in addition to the special relationship between the Persian people and their king, that makes it a very special relationship that maybe some other people could not understand.
مراسم تاجگذاری شاه و فرح بود. من اون موقع ها خیلی علاقمند بودم به هنرهای ظریف و از این جهت تمام کارهایی که اینا میکردن لحاظ مثلا طراحی دنبال میکردم. به خاطر همینم مثلا رفتم توی خیابون اون موقع شاه رضا بود که کالسکه رد میشد. تو اون کالسکه هم مخصوصا با اون لباس فرح خیلی سمید. خیلی هم طولانی و اینا خیس عرق بود تو اون کالسکه قشن یادم با شاه. اصلا سیاسی نبودم و بیشتر تحت تاثیر فقر و بیچارگی و مشکلات جامعه و اینجور چیزا از یک طرف و از طرف دیگه که اون موقع اصلا انتخابات مطرح بود و همه آدم هایی که بودن دوربر شاه نظر من آدم های چاپلوس و دستبوس و غیر و اینا که اصلا با روحیه ماها همخوانی نداشت. هر چقدر قدم به قدم رفتیم جلو آتش اینو داشتیم که یاد بگیریم، بفهمیم، ببینیم تو جامعه چی میگذره، جای ما کجاست، ما با مانع مواجه میشیم. یعنی حتی اون موقع خوندن یک کتاب مشکل بود. کافی بود یکی از اینا از ما میگرفتن، بعد به حد مرگ میبردن میزدن، تا اینکه بالاخره طرف اگر ضعف نشون میداد بودن چی؟
من نوکرش بودم، وزیرش بودم، دامادش بود. شاه مرد شرافتمندی بود، شاه مردی بود که کشورش دوست داشت، شاه مرد خانواده بود، آدم باهوشی بود، آدم خوشقلبی بود، همه اینا رو داشت. حالا چون نیست ما میخوایم همه رو گردن اون بندازیم.
For the first time, we see the new Shah arriving at Parliament House to take over the reins of office in succession to his abdicated father. Shapur Mohammad Reza, the former Crown Prince, now occupies the peacock throne. The new Shah has had to provide evidence that he'll display a less pro-German attitude than his deposed predecessor. The ex-Shah of Persia exploited his people until his own coffers were filled to overflowing. The new Shah has no easy task ahead of him. Iran is likely to remain much in the news.
ببینید، شاه اولا اصلا انتظار نداشتش که پدرش استعفا بده، بنابراین براش سورپرایز بود. حتی معروفه که موقعی که پدرش میرفته گریه میکرد، میگفته منم با خودت ببر. از این نظر خیلی ناراحت بود، بنابراین هنوز نمیدونه سلطنت یعنی چی. و از طرفی هم شخصیت پدرش رو نداشت، برای اینکه پدرش قدرت رو با زور گرفته بود، با کودتا گرفته بود و یک نظامی بود. شاه نه، شاه یه بچه بود که در سوئیس تحصیل کرده بود، میگیم توی پر قو بزرگ شده بود. بنابراین کاراکتر، تربیت، بک‌گراند و گذشته پدرش رو نداشت، ولی میخواست ادای پدرش رو در بیاره.
دو چیز آدمای ضعیف خراب میکنه، یکی پوله، یکی مقام. وقتی به اونجا رسیدن کور میشه.
Today, well, 69 heads of state and it's quite a list. Either the heads themselves or their representatives. The list includes one emperor, eight kings, five queens, 15 presidents, five emirs, four ruling princes, two governor generals, two heirs apparent, four junior princes, three vice presidents including vice president Agnew, four prime ministers, seven sheikhs, and one wife of a president.
And that's everything but a partridge in a pear tree. اگه میدونستیم چی، هیچ وقت جرأت یه همچی کاری نداشتیم، ولی افتادیم تو این کار. من اون وقت وارد داستان شدم که همون مهرماه 1970 بود. یه روزی والازاد اشرف من رو احضار کردم و گفتن که علازاد تصمیم گرفتن که جشن شاهنشاهی در سال آینده برگزار بشه. شما برین کارهای ایشون رو تحویل بگیرین و تا روزی که جشن تموم نشده شما اونجا باشید. در اون زمان کسی اصلا شورای جشن ها رو جدی نمی گرفت. رفتم با آقای علام صحبت کردم که وزیر دربار بود. بهشون گفتم زور دربار رو پشت این بذارین که همه دستگاه ها متوجه اهمیت کار بشه. بعضشون رسید، فرمودن که یک کمیته عالی تشکیل بشه به ریاست وزیر دربار. بعد از اون یه خودکار جدی تر شد. سازمان جلب سیاحان دو تا هتل پیشبینی کرده بودن، یکی در شیراز، یکی در تخت جمشید. آقای علم گفتن همه دست جمعی بریم به شیراز. در توی شهر اولا خیابان های کثیف و دیوارهای خراب، بعد رسیدیم به هتل کوروش. هتلی اونجا نبودش، فقط یه اسکلت فلزی بود که تازه داشتن سرهم میکردن. رفتیم به طرف تخت جمشید. یه جاده دو خطه پر از اسفالتای از بین رفته تا رسیدیم به تخت جمشید. تخت جمشید اون موقع تا چشم کار میکرد بیابان بود. هیچی نبود اونجا. یه دفعه همه متوجه شدن که چقدر ما در حقیقت از مرحله پرتیم. برگشتیم به شیراز. آقای علام گفتن که آقا اینجا یک کار مملکتی. اگر سر موقع این کارا همه درست نشه من هفته ور میذارم یکی شما رو میکشم. بعدم خودم میکشم. چون این آبروی مملکت ما خواهد رو. چند روز بعدش که اینو مطرح کردم. این بیابون پر از مار و عقرب بود. اصلا موضوع پذیرایی و این چیزها رو در شیراز و مهمونهای اینا رو بهتر حذف کنیم. آقای علم گفتن که دعوتنامه ها رفته نمیشه به هم بزنیم. دیگه کار تموم دیگه باید انجام بشه. ولی اینجا دیگه به فکر من رسید یه کاری بکنیم که اینجا جای امنی باشه هستم. 30 کیلومتری تخت جمشید سمپاژی کردم و یک کامیون پر از مار و عقرب از اونجا جمع کرده.
بذار این یکی مار جعفری خطرناک.
اهورا مازدا واز سمبل اف لایت گاد اف لایت ان اهریمن واز دیول فرند اند انمی گرین اند درای.
Intellectuals had been arguing since the late 19th century that the reason for colonialism, the reason for Iran's weakness is Islam. When the Shah's father and his ministers took over, most of them were educated in Western institutions. They're very adamant about modernity, Westernization, as well as going back to ancient roots. So culture or cultural revival was part of a larger agenda of secularizing Iran.
یه روز گذشت یه پادشاه از یه جا اون قدیم قد بلند و توپ رضا خان اسمش رو نگی سگ بود اخلاقش همه مثل سگ ازش میترسیدن حرف کم میزد گفت ره راهن کشیدن حرف کم میزد گفت چه چادر رو برچیدن آی ملت مدرنیتر و اخلاق سگ آب آی ملت مدرنیتر و اخلاق سگ آب آی ملت چارقد و شلیتر و اخلاق سگ آب.
Throughout his reign, the Shah was very conscious of his father's legacy, but also I think he wanted to distinguish himself from his father in the sense that I can do this better.
I never saw him in exile. I was exchanging letters. He will never try to really tell me what to do. Only one recommendation. Don't be afraid of anything, ever. That is not possible. I mean, physically, I'm not afraid of anything, ever. Death doesn't mean anything for me. I have seen it so many times right in front of myself, in my eyes. And I know that the day will come. When the day comes, nothing will stop it. But mentally, constantly afraid of something.
شما اگر تاریخ رو تاریخ ایران رو بدونید در سالهای 50 اختلافی که بین مصدق و شاه بود در این جمله خلاصه میشد شاه باید سلطنت کند نه حکومت مصدق مثل نخست وزیرهای قبلی نبود مصدق میخواست برگرده به قانون اساسی و شاه فقط بشه سلطنت مشروطه و شاه اینو نمیخواست شاه میدید که روز به روز داره قدرتش رو از دست میده
Attention is focused once again on the Middle East where events in Iran have taken a dramatic double twist. Forced to flee his palace in Tehran, The Shah and his queen arrive in Rome after an alleged attempt by the Imperial Guard to arrest Dr. Mossadegh and a refusal by the Shah to dissolve Parliament at Mossadegh's request.
I had not abandoned hope. My heart was light. It took only 2 days before the people called me back.
بالاخره خب مصدق با کودتای آمریکایی انگلیسی میدونید که سقوط کرد.
Until 53, my life was a succession of pain and suffering and humiliation.
So he comes back in 1953, knowing very well that this was a foreign engineered coup d'etat in his name, knowing very well that, you know, he is coming into a country that essentially does not want him. So what does he have to do as a politician? There are two ways. One way would be trying again to be the people's monarch within, again, a context that was still in flux. There's a lot of radicalism, a lot of disenchantment, right? Or ruling with a strong hand. And the Shah, with increasing funds through the oil revenues, with increasing confidence in his alliance with the United States, he established a militarized security state, trying to find out how I can keep myself in office as a monarch.
تعطیلات عید پیش می آمد آقای علم رفتم به اروپا
Je ne sais pas si l'année de plus blonde mais de plus belle il n'en est pas pour moi Elle est vraiment toute la joie du monde ma vie commence dès que je la vois et je fais oh et je fais ah C'est si bon
آقای علم تا برگشتن جلسه تشکیل دادن و اشاره کردن گفتن که شاید هم بد نباشه ما اونجا چادر بزنیم پذیرایی کنیم چون در زمان قدیم هم چادر میزدن این مؤسسه فرانسوی جانسن طرحی تهیه کرده که ما یک خونه های پیش ساخته بسازیم روش هم یه چیز پلاستیکی میکشیم به صورت چادر
Mr. Alam was very efficient. I think it was his character to get it done. He found the simplest way to do it, to go to a professional, to do the tents, to do the food, to do the catering, the servants.
I'm going to Maxime's, to lose myself in dreams.
Maxime, à cette époque, était considéré dans l'une des meilleures tables. La direction, M. Vaudable, avait fait connaître Maxime vraiment dans le monde entier. Nous étions à Boston parce que Maxime avait fait un gala à l'opéra de Boston. Nous dînions avec M. Vaudable et il a dit « Je ne vous dis rien encore, mais vous allez vivre de grands moments. » Ma première action, c'était une grande inquiétude et un enthousiasme pour apporter une petite pierre à cet événement quand même mondial.
Hein. اینی که پادشاهان بیانه اصلا صحبت این حرفا اون موقع نبود بعد از اینی که آقای علم این قرارداد رو با مؤسسه جانسن و مکسیم بستن توجه زیاد شد به این جشن و از این طریق بودش که چشم همچشمی پیدا شد
Sur un terrain d'aviation proche de Paris viennent d'être montées deux tentes géantes Ces tentes sont destinées au camp qui va être dressé à Persépolis pour la célébration du 2500e anniversaire de la fondation de l'Empire de Perse par Cyrus le Grand.
Cyrus the Great has this sort of religious political value. He's ostensibly in the Quran, he's definitely in the Bible. The Greeks love him. The Persians clearly valued him a lot. I mean, he's one of the few that has a tomb outside. You know, it's the one tomb that nobody's demolished at any time. He's a figure that all political factions in a way also can buy into. He's a humanist. He's an Enlightenment leader. He emancipated. He liberated the Jews. He likes minorities. He treated people with dignity. And Cyrus becomes this blank slate onto which the Shah projects his own image so that he may be reflected in his glory.
He was the first to introduce justice. He was the first man who introduced the Bill of Rights. We have the scroll. Well, you have the real scroll in your museum. You took it from us.
کاش که تو جامعه ما اون حرف ها مثلا پا می گرفت و می رفت جلو. شاه هر قدم که رفت جلو و سیستم ساواک و سرکوبش و اینا درست مخالف اون چیزایی که تو اون لوحه کوروش نوشته عمل کرد. ساواک شب ری خونه ما. سر 11 نیم شب بود مادرم من بیدار کرد اسمان بلند شو ساواکی ها خونه پرن همه جا رو گشتن و هیچی گیر نیاوردن برام باورم نمیشد این همه کتاب تو خونه حتما شانس آوردن دیگه اینجاها شدیم سیاسی یعنی واقعا این چه سیستمیه
I think the problem of the White Revolution was in many ways a top-down process that was primarily, I think, geared towards positioning the Shah as that benevolent monarch who gives out charity almost to Iranians. So it was in many ways an act of propaganda more than anything else.
If you're unhappy that your country is saying goodbye to a feudalistic system, if you're unhappy that half of the population of your country, the women, are emancipated, well, this I cannot help.
Khomeini was pure cleric. His grandfather, his father, all of them were steeped in Islamic theology. And this whole idea that Iran was not primarily an Islamic country was for him utterly unacceptable.
اول خمینی نامه می‌نویسه به شاه. که آقا این کارا رو نکنید. این کارا مخالف اسلام و اینها. شاه نه فقط جواب نمیده، کمانده ها می‌ریزن توی مدرسه فیضیه در و پنجره ها رو میشکنن و حتی شاید یکی دو نفر کشته میشن عده زیادی دستگیر میشن خب اینجا دیگه اعلام جنگ با آخوندها یه عده از رجال سابق که بیشتر هم همکارای پدرش بودن میان بهش میگن این کارو نکن این کار خطرناکه تمام اینا رو دستور میده اخراج میکنن یعنی دیگه با اینا کار نمیکنه و این جنریشن جدید هست کسی اون شخصیت نداره که بگه آه رای شما اشتباه شما دارید هم خودتون و همه ما رو میبرید به جهنم.
I had to ascend one of those stubborn obscurantist clergymen abroad. He had to travel.
این انقلاب ننگین و خونین به اصطلاح سفید که در یک روز با تانک و مسلسل 15,000 مسلمان را آنطور که معروف است از پای درآورد روزگار ملت را سیاه تر ساخت. در بسیاری از شهرستانها و اکثر روستاها دکتر و دارو وجود ندارد. از مدرسه، حمام و آب آشامیدنی سالم خبری نیست. در بعضی از دهات کودکان معصوم را از گرسنگی به چرا می برند. ولی دستگاه جبار صدها میلیون تومان از سرمایه این مملکت را صرف جشن‌های ننگین می‌کند و از همه مصیبت‌ها بالاتر جشن منحوس 2500 ساله شاهنشاهی. دنیا بداند که این جشن‌ها مربوط به ملت شریف و مسلمان ایران نیست و دایر کننده و شرکت کننده این جشن‌ها خائن به اسلام و به ملت ایران می‌باشند.
I'm probably more religious than those people myself. This is the story of my life. I'm mystical, I'm religious, but I believe the true religion, the religion of God, the religion of our prophet, and not what has been added to it by those who want to make it a job, a profiteering job for themselves.
Ici, dans cette plaine désertique du sud, le problème fondamental, c'est l'eau. L'arrivée du petit train est attendue avec impatience. Que souhaitez-vous le plus au monde?
Une meilleure vie, beaucoup d'argent, pouvoir m'amuser.
Mais est-ce qu'il n'y a pas quelque chose de spécial?
Tout me ferait plaisir. Je ne sais pas.
Rien ne vous tente particulièrement?
Une machine à coudre.
Avez-vous déjà vu le chat?
Non, je ne l'ai jamais vu, mais j'aimerais le voir. C'est mon désir le plus cher.
Qui est le chat?
Le chat est un grand dieu. C'est le dieu du peuple. Quand nous prions pour le chat. Nous l'aimons beaucoup.
The word Shah in Iran was associated to perfection. And Iranians really did like the Shah. They associated themselves, at least when I was young, to the Shah, to the country having a Shah. Shah was part of our everyday life.
The greatest show on earth is also going to be one of the most select. The Shahs invited 60 of the world's heads of state from as far away as Norway and Nepal, Lesotho and Liechtenstein to spend 3 days with him in this special royal village. There's even a British delegation.
When Princess Anne and the Duke arrive here at Persepolis for the three-day party, they'll be accommodated, like all the rest of the 60 heads of state, in a tent. In fact, we're told, in this tent, although protocol might change their minds and switch everybody round. Now, this is the sort of thing they'll have in each of these tents. There are six cut glasses on a tortoiseshell tray. There's this perfumed candle in a glass cylinder with a decorative snake and an ornamental Iranian ashtray.
For morning tea, all Princess Anne will have to do is give a little tinkle on her bedside bell. For near at hand is her personal maid, who sleeps on a foldaway bed in the kitchen. It's fully equipped, as are all the arrangements. The tents are all tastefully situated in a forest of young trees, 15,000 of them flown in specially from Versailles, not to mention the 15,000 flowering shrubs. And then in the top secret banqueting tent is the food, 4 tons of it, again all from Paris. There's even a French-built royal club.
Est-ce que vous êtes heureuse finalement de ces fêtes, avant qu'elles ne commencent en tout cas?
C'est un peu comme le couronnement quand on me pensait. On a tellement de choses à faire, une tellement grande responsabilité pour vraiment tout. On est en train de montrer, on est en train de célébrer 2500 ans de culture et d'histoire d'un pays. De voir que tout aille bien et il faut voir tous les petits détails C'est surtout, on est tellement occupé, on travaille, on n'a pas le temps. C'est après qu'on va peut-être penser qu'est-ce que c'était et comment on s'est sentu. Maintenant, c'est le travail.
Worked 8 seasons at the Palace Hotel in St. Moritz. In the palace, they called me after the season. They called me up. They said, Shah of Iran is making a big party. So we are all going to Persepolis.
We were about 40, 50 people from the palace.
I took the train from my home valley. I brought myself a Swiss sausage and a piece of bread. My friends, they already went to Tehran before, and they went to the Hilton Hotel and had some caviar and champagne.
As we go to the play, everybody was quiet because a lot of them were afraid to fly. The most of them never had been in a plane. Und dann sind wir von, mag ich mich noch erinnern, da war ein Freund von mir, und sagte, da unter diesem Boden, das ist alles volles Öl.
من که فرزند این سرزمینم در پی توشه ای خوش چینم شادم از پیشه خوش چینی.
The Scandinavian monarchs had hired a plane for the three of them, and I went into that plane with my Greek cousin, King Constantine. And in the plane, I remember that I was discussing the jewels that the queens in the plane were bringing. Queen Anne-Marie said, I'm bringing the emeralds, which are huge. I mean, they were Romanov emeralds, and everyone was bringing the best. I said, listen, compared to what Empress Farah is going to show, it's peanuts, because she has the most important jewels on earth.
At the beginning, I thought it was just bling bling and... As they say in Germany, schickimicki. That is a little bit smart and snob, but nothing interesting. So then I changed my mind. Les arbres avaient été plantés en plein désert et je croyais qu'il s'agissait d'une légende parce qu'on a raconté aussi, et c'était vrai, qu'on a apporté plus de 50 000, je crois, enfin un nombre incroyable d'oiseaux pour qu'ils soient là et qu'en 3 jours ils sont morts puisqu'ils ne supportaient pas le climat.
He ordered sparrows, lots and lots of sparrows from Spain. There were not enough water around for all the birds, you know. But it was suddenly for unfair now. Yeah, it was not very nice. But he wanted to make it look like a forest. I don't know why he bring all these trees to the desert.
Ils ont créé un golf avec des bunkers, des greens, des vallons, et c'était extraordinaire. Alors que partout ailleurs, c'était sec, c'était de la caillasse, du désert.
On avait du mal à imaginer qu'on pouvait installer une telle cuisine, pâtisserie, chambre froide. J'avais été vraiment très, très surpris.
For days and days, a big aeroplane full of ice was delivered, a big block of ice, and put in a desert. Big like a garage, you know, like a carport. A block of ice delivered every day, and we all go to the desert to cool us down on this ice, but nobody knew. Only the last day I realized that this ice has to be chopped into pieces for the ice buckets for the white wine.
Well, I must have read about it, but it just seemed like, since I was a party reporter, that's what I was hired to do, that this was going to be the ultimate party and that I should be there. I stayed in Tehran for several days. One of the interesting things that happened was, and I later wrote about this in my stories, was how unhappy so many people were about the celebration and what kind of criticism they were getting for spending all of this money when they didn't have enough money to send children to school or to feed children. And when I was there, I met with them and they said, we're going to take you to a meeting, an underground meeting, but we have to blindfold you to take you there. I was in this room and there were these, oh, they were all men, and they were very angry at the Shah. And they basically said, you know, this is a trumped up empire. The guy's father was a peasant. He's not an emperor. And then they're spending hundreds of millions of dollars on this festival, which we can't afford in this country.
سه تا گوینده به ما پیشنهاد شد. جیمز میسون یکی یک گوینده تلویزیون بود که میگفتن خیلی خوبه و یکی هم اورسون ولز.
سایرس کینگ آف کینگز چمپیون لانگ بیفور مگنا کارتا آف هیومن رایتس اند لیبرتیز سایرس the founder of Persian culture and the father of Iran, the land five times the size of Great Britain, which this Shah rules today. It had fallen to him, after a twilight in his nation's long history, to remind the world and his own people of Persian pride.
It was out of this world. I had a shiver going down my spine. It was remarkable. When the Shah addresses Cyrus and he says, sleep well, we are alert. Bechab na bidari. Kurosh bechab na bidari. Bidar nabuda.
Kurosh. شاه بزرگ.
What was extraordinary, that as Shah was speaking, suddenly on both sides of the tomb, the dust devil, in spiral of dust, he repeats, and it goes again up. So it was an extraordinary. And I said, how did they accomplish that? I thought that was prepared. It was like a play, vaudeville. It was like an opera, the stage. And I was moved.
Osiris, great king, king of kings, Achaemenian king, king of the land of Iran, I, the Shah and Shah of Iran, offer thee salutations from myself and from my nation. At this glorious moment in the history of Iran, I and all Iranians, the offspring of the empire which thou founded 2,500 years ago, bow our heads in reverence before thy tomb.
واقعا برای جامعه ایران اولا دوره خیلی سختی بود، گفتم از نظر ترور، از نظر دوران وحشت، فشار و اینها. بعدم همه چیش خیلی مصنوعی و ظاهرسازی و مسخره بود. یعنی واقعا وقتی گفت کوروش بخواب ما بیداریم، it's joking. برای همه مردم it's joking. یعنی من فکرم از اون زمان دیگه شاه به کلی تبدیل شد به یه سمبول مسخره و حتی سمبول نفرت در ایران.
بسیار پرمعنی و هنوز بعد از این همه سال وقتی شما بخونین میبینین که چقدر سخنرانی قشنگی. اونهایی که با این دستگاه مخالف بودن یک جمله‌ش رو گرفتن که کوروش آسوده بخواب که ما بیداریم.
این او حرفاش درست کرده بودن، آسوده بخواب ما ایران رو برباد میدهیم، آسوده بخواب نفتش رو برباد میدهیم، آسوده بخواب سرمایه‌هاش رو برباد میدهیم، همینجور برای ساخته بودن.
The last day before everything started, Mr. Alam came and asked all of us to come into the big hall. And he said, listen, from tomorrow, you are on your own. If you get into trouble, you have to improvise and solve your problem on your own. Think you are in war. I still get excited, goose pimples when I remember these words.
In the middle of October 1971, 62 heads of state converged on the airport of the fairy tale city of Shiraz. In a patchwork of color, in a whirl of salutes, bows and curtsies, familiar faces in the world scene stepped out of their aircraft over red carpets fringed with guards of honor into the welcoming Persian sunlight. It was just like this. Too much was happening to pick out the detail. For all the arrivals, ceremony and protocol had to be carefully observed. None who were there saw it all. So began one of the most historic cultural gatherings the world has ever seen.
The only person that was sitting in headquarters in Persepolis was me. I couldn't sleep. I was scared to death. Because something this elaborate, any small thing that could happen would be a scandal. One of these African countries requested through our embassy that they'd like to bring 10 people with the head of state. 5 was the maximum. He said these are his personal guards, that 2 of them must sleep under his bed. So His Majesty said, okay, let this one have his 10. And he brought 10 guys. Haile Selassie came with 75 people on a plane. I remember I went nuts because these guys, who's going to take care of 85 people?
I've never seen a tent like this before. It's not like your average camping tent. They were like little homes. I mean, they were gorgeous, and everything looked like it had come right out of a decorating magazine. You could pull up your chair and sit outside your tent. So some of the kings and queens were kind of sitting outside their tent, or some had the tents open, you know, the sort of Prince Philip waving at, you know, the King of Denmark, and somebody else waving, and then Grace Kelly and Prince Rainier, and everybody sort of, hi, how are you? Good to see you. They'd stop and chat. I've never seen anything like it, and there's never been anything like it since.
Everything was done with the most exquisite taste, and it was not at all nouveau riche, not at all gold everywhere or marbles. It was good taste.
C'était des tentes fort belles, bien entendu, enfin très banales, et dans chaque tiroir, il y avait toujours, sauf votre respect, un aquacelzer et un tampax, ce qui quand même réduisait les grands de ce monde à bien peu de choses.
You couldn't walk three steps without falling over some security guard. The king of Denmark was trying to get through to something, and they threw him out, and only later did they find out that he was the king of Denmark. It was very tight, very tight.
گفته میشد که از اون کوهایی که شمار تخت جمشید هست ممکنه یه ده گوریلا حرکت کنن این بساطو به هم بزنن.
In 1971, there was more and more guerrilla warfare, not only in Iran, but elsewhere as well. The Vietnam counterculture, the revolutions happening in Cuba, seeing Che Guevara. These people were not reformers. They were not bourgeois, middle class, you know, people who were worried about their mortgage. They were worried about changing their countries, but also world history.
مخالفت با این رژیم از دید این رژیم فرق نمی کنه که شما سیاسی بکنی یا با اسلحه بکنی. پس با اسلحه بکنی.
تمامی دانشگاه ها موقع جشن 2500 ساله تعطیل شدن. همه رو میبستن. به خاطر چی؟ به خاطر اینکه یه امنیتی به وجود بیارن که بتونن جشن ها برگزار بکنن. زندونا رو پر کردن. همه نماینده های دانشجو تو زندان بودن. همه.
Est-il exact que la contestation est interdite à l'université?
Quelle contestation? Avec quoi? Contre quoi? Contre la politique de notre pays, qui est notre politique d'indépendance nationale? Je crois que la question ne se pose pas. Personne n'en parle.
This is a period when the Shah, among many critics in the West, was seen as essentially a tin pot dictator, not a liberal man at all.
حدود پنج پادشاه و پنج رئیس جمهور شرکت نکردند. بهانه ها که آورده بودند بی‌معنا بود و واقعا تحت فشار فضایی بود که در این کشورها ایجاد شده بود و اونها ناگزیر شرکت نکردند.
Some of them were fairly felt a bit awkward about the pretensions the Shah was portraying. Clearly in Britain for instance they were not keen for the Queen to go because they thought if he's pushing it about that he's the premier monarch in the world or this, you know, we don't want to be in a position where our monarchs are seen as, you know, paying homage to the king of kings.
شما وقتی کشورها سر رؤسای کشورهای دنیا رو فراهم جمع میکنی اونجا در واقع به اون جامعه میگی که نماینده از اونا داری جشن برای مردم نمیگیری برای اونا میگیری پس اونا از دید شما محورند و اهمیت دارند نه مردم خود شما
من یادمه چون من یه ماه قبل از جشن رو گرفتن خیابون شاه رضا رو همه جاش رو تزیین میکردن زندان خیلی پر بود اینقدر پر بود جای خواب نبود جایی که من میخوابیدم و اینا واقعا جایی بود که خب قدم کوتاه و اینا هیچکی نمیتونست بخوابه اینقدر پام رو هوا بود
Your Majesty, there are some people who feel that Iran should not be spending millions of dollars on this celebration. While there are still people in need, how do you answer these critics and why do you think it was important to have this celebration?
First of all, how do they know about what is spent? Really, the only expenses that are made for the festivities are the two official dinners that we are going to give our guests. This is the least that we could do for such a gathering.
Everybody arrived at the entrance of that big tent at 8 o'clock. It was more than surreal. It was unbelievable. It was the biggest event of my life. To see all these people, it was so little place. For example, they hadn't invited all the ministers. The cabinet was not there. Many Iranians were not, even Iranians were not invited. There was no room. Simply no room.
people hadn't planned exactly what they were going to do with all these monarchs. I mean, they had them in their tent cities, but then what? Nobody had really thought what was going to happen once they all came in the huge tent. And so the Shah and the Shahbanu were there to greet them, the guests, and they started piling up because they couldn't get through the receiving line quickly.
The problem is that not everybody arrived on time, and not everybody went in within 2 or 3 minutes. So after some time, there was a queue. According to the rules of protocol, kings take precedence against others due to their permanence. So they had to go in first. There were too many of them, and more were coming. So there were two queues, one of kings and queens, and one of lesser mortals, like presidents and prime ministers. So it was just unbelievable.
And then there was this huge dust storm that came up, and that was trying to, and people's hairdos were getting undone, and the crowns were being held on so they wouldn't blow off, and the dresses were swirling, and the dust was getting people's eyes, and they were trying to push their way in so they wouldn't have to stand out in the dust storm.
This storm just came up the wrong time. I was scared that this big chandelier will fall on somebody's head, you know, the people were, it was like the end of the world. This was not exactly what he expected for opening up the party.
Finally, everybody was sort of piling in, and they didn't know what to do, and a lot of the Europeans were related to each other, but a lot of people didn't know each other. There wasn't anybody there to sort of say, oh, you know, the Emperor of Japan, I want you to meet, that's Haile Selassie, you know. So these people would sort of stand off in corners and stare at each other.
How were the royals and the communists?
The best. Communists and royals went on to perfection, as it very often happens. Even if the Russians had murdered, I don't know how many royals, but that was all in the old days.
Weight of fainted before the party, and we had to carry him, give him some medicine to calm him down. 5 people had to hold him. We had to put him to the medical, there was a medical tent, and we had to give him tranquilizers, and he just couldn't take it, the pressure. He just kept, 5 people had to hold him because he didn't know what he was doing anymore. And it was a tremendous pressure. You know, you have all the head of states, and then the food is not properly ready. So that's not exactly what you're looking for as a head waiter. But I don't think the customer realized it because they had so much to talk together when they arrived. And whether it's half an hour later or not, I think they had enough time to talk together. I don't think the customers realized that we were in panic.
And it was very hot in the kitchen area, so the people in the kitchen area were practically nude. They'd taken off most of their clothes. And a lot of them were, the men were sort of in these bikini underwear.
This was the big book where the menu is inside. So this is a very nice glass. You could show, see where you are. So with the first plate was œuf de caille or perle de bandar Pahlavi.
Everything the best. 1,000 kilo caviar. It's caviar, you know, it's not bread.
There was caviar at the big dinner, but no, they were not night and day caviar, no.
Protocol was a nightmare of all nightmares at this thing. Everybody was sort of looking to see where everybody else was seated and who had a better seat and who had a better ranking. So all that was going on at the same time.
It was very interesting to watch all this intrigue. 3 people used to serve 1 table. Each one controlled the other.
They were from the army checking that we don't put any poison in the food or something.
Les vins, c'était les meilleurs crus de France, les meilleures années et les meilleurs vins.
Champagne, 2,500 bottles.
Château de Brionne, Château Latour, Château Lafitte.
Bordeaux, 1,000 bottles. Bourgogne, 1,000 bottles.
The second plate was a mousse de queue d'écrevisse sauce nantois, sel d'agneau de grand plateau farci et rôti dans son jus.
L'agneau de l'agneau français. Hein. Désossé avec une farce d'uxelles de champignons, truffes et foie gras. Et à la tête du plat, il y avait une tête de bélier.
To tell you the truth, me personally, I almost didn't eat anything. I was only looking around, looking at people. The tablecloth was 100 and something meters long in one piece.
Pao à l'impérial paraît entouré de sa cour.
Tavus, asaman hich farq nashdam kes gusht tavus bokhore.
Alors le pan, bien sûr, mais c'était que le décor, le pan. On a désossé, farci des petites cailles avec du foie gras, avec des truffes. Donc on a présenté des cailles avec au milieu le pan pour la beauté du plat, quoi.
The sound and light show was, I remember that it was very cold and very windy, and everybody was really tired and would rather have gone back to their tent instead of bundling up and going up to the top of the hill to watch a sound and light show.
Open the gates guarded by winged bulls with human heads.
مراسم که تموم شد چراغ روشن نشد و همه چی تاریک تاریک بود.
It was 3 minutes. 3 minutes is a long time.
دویدم که برم که توی اون اتاق کنترل ببینم که چی اتفاق افتاده. یه دقیقه دو دقیقه ای که این فاصله بود خمپارهایی که مفجر شده بود خیلی همه رو به وحشت انداخته بود خیال کردن خرابکارا ریختن یه کاری کردن
In San Francisco, there was an explosion in the Iranian consulate during the night that set fires throughout the three-story stone building. There was heavy damage, but no one was injured. Numbers of Iranians around the country had protested the Shah of Iran's lavish celebration of the 2500th anniversary of his dynasty, a celebration on which we'll have live coverage by satellite later in this half hour.
تمام تلویزیون‌های دنیایی در تمام جا داشتن نشونش می‌دادن. این شاید باید خرج بکنید برای این کار که همچون پابلیستی خوب بگیرید. در این قسمت کسی نمیتونه بگه که خوب نبود. فقط اون مراسم میتونست این رو باعث بشه که شما از 70 مملکت داشته باشین بنشینن توی تخت جمشید و راجع به تاریخ ایران در حقیقت آموزش ببینن که اصلا این مملکت چی بوده، چی شده، چه مراحل گذرونده. وقتی که اینا از دور شروع کردن به حرکت با اون تد و هلا رو زدن و تبلا رو زدن و شیپورا رو کشتن با اون نظمی که اومدن رد شدن اصلا همه دهنشون باز مونده بود
are firmly on our feet. And by the grace of God, we are going to progress. And with or without the sympathy of the outside countries or people, we shall enter the era of the great civilization. We shall regain our past prestige. And I hope that you will know that I'm not speaking in a spirit of vanity. I am full of humility, but I am very sure of my people and very sure of our destiny.
The great civilization was the word which was repeated many, many times in every speech and in every headline of the newspaper. It was to give us a sense of pride and to help us go ahead with the modernization of Iran and to be sure of ourselves as Iranians.
به عنوان یه ایرونی یک احساس عجیبی بر من پیدا شد که الانم که میگم باز همونطور اثر میذاره روم. ایرونی که هیچ کسی قبولش نداشت توی دنیا جز کشورهای عقب مونده بودش. وقتی دیدم که یه همچی چیزی واقعا اثر گذاشتم. بله.
کان اینا اینجوری بود. یه راست می‌بردن اتاق شکنده. اگر شما قرار بگیرن، کتاب بگیرن، کسی راجع به شما حرف زده باشه، اینقدر میزنن تا بالاخره پدر شما رو در بیارن که شما هم دو کلام بیشتر بگی.
What I can say is that we are now sophisticated enough to use the same methods that you people are using for interrogating the people that you have to.
Who are you referring to, sir?
Any of the sophisticated societies, they have some very efficient system of interrogation, which is much more psychological than physical. We do the same things as you're doing.
And do you regard that as justified?
That depends on what cases. In case of betrayal of one's country, I could say anything goes.
میگفتن دستار میبستن و پاها را میبستن. انواع اقسام شلاقا داشتن که دردهای مختلف میده. مثلا با شلاق کلوفتر میزنن و این بعد این مثلا میبینن پا خیلی باد کرده با شلاق باریکتر میزنن متوجه این چون بعض وقتا یه چیز خیلی کلوف که میزنن اصلا میزنه میشکنه انگشت منگشتها رو
You can see films for instance You can hear stories that even in police precincts A police officer or detective gets so mad at the behavior of the fellow that he has just arrested that he loses all his head and he just punches on that fellow or breaks a chair on his head. These are some kind of human reactions that it's almost beyond control.
حقوق بشر کسی من نمیتونه به رئیس جمهوراش گفتم درس بده چون ما به اینا درس دادیم عملم کرد اینا که اصلا دیگه نه حقوق بشری دارن نه همه اینه که امروز در قرن 21 میبینیم حقوق بشر توشه مای فوت
Allah این همه میلیاردها پول خرج کردن برای این تظاهرات بی‌معنی هیچی، برای اینکه تاریخ ایران تاریخ ایران بود. یعنی شو میداد، یعنی تو با همه این کارا نمیتونی ما رو گول بزنی. رژیم تو یه رژیم پلیسیه، حکومت تو یه حکومت پلیسیه، یه حکومت فاسده. بنابراین هی میخواد خودتو به عنوان جانشین کوروش، ولی نه، یعنی این تو به بزرگی و عظمت و اعتبار ایران چیزی اضافه نکردی.
What is it that makes an Iranian? What is the quality that binds the tribesman 1,000 miles away from here with the person giving a party in Tehran? What is the common bond that links them all?
I'm not making any propaganda, but I think it's the crown, the king.
That it's you?
At this moment, yes.
The climax of the celebrations. The first glimpse of the floodlit monument outside the airport of Tehran in honor of the present Shah.
That monument is a moment, sort of an iconic imagery that for them speaks about the good life. And I think what is so tragic about that is that that good life is always in the past.
When the planes left, Alam asked me over and said, take care of the tents. I went to each one and made a list of what's inside. Many of the things that were inside were gone already. They'd taken it. Now,
who taken the heads of state?
I have no idea. I don't want to accuse head of state for taking a telephone can radio. Because we ordered 50 of them for each tent. But when I counted, there was only one left. So maybe those who were working there took them.
حالا اونی که من حساب دقیق نکردم ببینم که چقدر، ولی اون وقت میگفتن 650 میلیون خرج برده دلار.
اینی که فکر کنین که تمام مملکت برای اون 50 تا چادر بود یک دروغ بی‌پایه‌ای که از تخیل یک کسی که درست بشه. یه مهمونی شما دارین، یه چند تا چادر هم میزنین، یه عده دعوت میکنین، بعدم میرن. این دیگه تمام زندگی شما که نیستش که.
اون فیلم در لندن برای اسپلیت اسکرینینگ برده بودم و کاراشو در لندن میکردیم. وقتی که فیلم رو از لندن فرستادم به تهران که آقای پهلبود ببینن و اینا، ولی اونا شب فیلم رو برده بودن برای اعلیحضرت نشون داده بودن. شاه وقتی که فیلمو دیده بود پرسیده پس مردم کجا هستن. وقتی این فیلمو دیده بعد از یک سال،
یعنی شما ایران رو وسطش رو یه جزیره درست کردید، اونجا واسه خودتون جشن میگیرید و مردم اونجا به غیر از بدبختی و فقر و فشار و زندان و اینها چیز دیگه ای نیست.
همه اینا رو متحد کرد به عزت خودش. نشیدم که یکی از مخالفین این نسبت به اونجاش حتی بی‌طرف مونده باشه. انتقاداتی که گفتم عمومی بود، از چپ بود تا نجف که آقای خمینی باشه.
خدای تعالی حضرت موسی را می‌فرستد که برو این شاهنشاه را که طغیان کرده و از قانون الهی سرپیچی کرده از بین ببر. و به ما میفهماند که باید به کار دولت و به سیاست اهتمام داشته باشیم و فرعون‌ها و شاهنشاهان را از تخت سرنگون کنیم. اگر زنده و یک رأی و متحد باشیم کار از پیش میبریم. قدرت خدا با مسلمانان متحد و یک رأی و یگانه است. حکام غیر مسلمان و پادشاهان مثل کفتار و حیوانات زندگی می کنند. آتش جایگاهشان خواهد بود.
I think it's a very high caliber the person comes to say معذرت خواهی بخشیدن اینها یه چیزای کلمات زیبایی در زندگی
اما من به نام پادشاه شما بار دیگر در برابر ملت ایران سوگند خود را تکرار می کنم و تعهد متعهد می شوم که خطاهای گذشته و بیقانونی و ظلم و فساد دیگر تکرار نشده
ماها بعد معذرت می‌خواستیم از نخست وزیرهامون از با بزرگ شما گرفته تا بنده که یه وزیر بودم نه او اون خواسته ما درست عمل نکردیم ما هیچ کارهای شخصیمون رو قاطی کردیم با اینکه بد بودیم پدر شدر بودیم
It must be lonely to be Shahanshah
Yes, it's a very special case, if I can say so.
In what way is it special?
I mean, to be, as you say, the king of kings.
And it means that you're lonely because you really have no one to go to for advice who is above you.
Well, there's always God.
He was not the only one that I could blame. I blame myself. I know my husband blames himself. We started forgetting our own traditions, copying other modern countries. I remember that until I was maybe 15 or 16, I used to pray. After that, when I went to high school, I stopped praying and I forgot about religion in a way. I don't know, I blame myself because I didn't realize that my cook was a Muslim and he prayed three times a day and I would go in the kitchen to tell him what to cook in my bikini. And he would turn his back to me and make believe that he was doing something. I didn't realize that he didn't want to look at me. I didn't realize. We didn't realize that the country was Muslim.
این کشور کشور با عظمتی بوده این بالا پایین ها رو دیده و امروز هم جزء ممالکی است که دربارش هنوز صحبت میکنن عظمت ایران و ایرانی است. مخالف یا موافق او رو بهش افتخار برای هیچ ایرادی به 2500 سال نه تنها ندارم بهش افتخار
ما اصلا آزادی نداشتیم امنیت نداشتیم دلمون می‌خواست بخونیم دلمون می‌خواست بفهمیم دلمون می‌خواست راحت باشیم هر قدم که من نگاه میکنم میبینم که بهترین آدم ها رو دور من میگیرن برای چی؟ برای کتاب خوندن برای یه ذره ضد شاه حرف زدن نمیشد یعنی به ما میگفتن بله شما برید دختربازی بکنید علافی بکنید دنبال پول برید حتی حاضرین بهتون پولم بدیم ولی حرف سیاسی نزنید و اینم نمیشه تو هیچ جامعه ای نمیشه اونجا هم نشد تو دوره جمهوری اسلامی هم نمیشه تو فرانسه هم نمیشه هیچ جا نمیشه جلوی جوون رو گرفت جوون میخواد بفهمه راهشو پیدا بکنه
You are the one for me, for me, for me, formidable. You are my love, very, 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 véritable. Et je voudrais pouvoir un jour.